We stop on the way out of the Nagababa camp to visit with the Baba, who has held his right arm in the air for the past 30-something years. I assess the energy fields around him and within his arm, and I wonder if he can bend it. The limbs seem still and wasted, but then the sadhu's body is lean, as many of them are. Their food intake is simple, small, and relatively healthy. Vegetarians by choice, many have one small meal a day. Others live on chapati and chai, with sometimes a little rice or dal to sustain them. Some have yoga buff bodies, while few others are big with bulging waistlines that hide their unclad genitals. Naga means naked, and here in their camp we see everything. Some are covered in vibhuti or holy ashes that make the body blue in color and appearance. Their eyes stand out so big and brown, their teeth, if they have them, so shiny. The 93-year-old Nagababa's eyes were huge. His grin showed healthy teeth untouched by the usual signs of decay that we could see, would see, in a Western counterpart of this age. Actually, there are probably few Western counterparts to this Baba. In Gumila, we see so many sprightly octogenarians and older, much more than may be seen in the Western world. But more importantly than their youthful energy is the light that beams constantly from their eyes and the smile that instantly transforms their faces when they too tune in and feel our essence. Witnessing the feeding of the sadhus was another interesting insight. Swami Nandanand and I were soon in the habit of walking every afternoon at around 3:30 p.m. Usually a group would be with us, ranging from a few people to many, as each day would reveal additional flavors. One afternoon, after a short visit to the school where blind children were housed, educated, and cared for, we ended up at a huge ashram that had been feeding people two meals a day for well over a decade. At Gumila time, the ashram fed over 3,000 swamis twice a day in approximately 30 minutes, so it was a sight to witness on many levels. Firstly, the efficient processing of such a large number of people, the lining up, the entry into specific areas where they sat on mats in orderly rows, then their chanting and the blessings, the food distribution and receival process, the consumption and clean-up and completion, all of it silently attended to in song via a service that was efficiently rendered with loving acceptance of the game of duty and sadhu life. Just being there to witness the practicalities of it all was amazing, then to also receive the smiles and open-hearted interest of the sadhus themselves, who were so happy to see Westerners joining them, and then to later meet the women in the kitchens and mingle there with their sweat and smiles and greetings. All of it was so rewarding in so many ways, as it always can be when we open up to enjoy other ways of being. Later, we returned to our camp near the river, where I met a young wealthy Indian woman who was amazed at our choice to live in such simple camp conditions. For example, our two-bucket cold water washing system, or the hole in the concrete, the no toilet paper toilet. Yet I loved to be amongst it all, to engage in such simple rhythms, and to enjoy the spontaneity that often occurs in situations like these. Yes, hotel life can be cleaner, smoother, and even more comfortable, but sometimes it's good to leave all that behind and dive into a different rhythm that stretches and enhances us if we allow. Personally, I love everything about Gumila, as each day I feel stronger and clearer as the blending continues within and around me. The camp is filled with noise from 4 a.m. chants to the late-night chants that cease around midnight, to be followed by our sunrise visits to the Ganges, where our group meditates with the Swami. After morning satsang, we bathe each day in the Gangaji, meeting and greeting so many others who also come to do the same. Life here has its own sweet rhythm that is so easy to relax into, as each day presents another view, or a game that reveals another level in the field of energy harmonics. So many stories and meetings and greetings occurred within the Gumba Mela situation for us all of us learning in whatever way we were open to learn, all of us harmonizing and blending in perfect ways, as happens when we are open to such things, all of us feeling enriched. Many on earth have now shifted their personal focus to look at new rhythms and ways of being. Data regarding prophecy and scripture on 2012 timelines and more now floods our internet, along with future humanist discussions, advanced nanotechnology, robotics, genetics and more. Ancient tools, mystery school insights, awareness and futuristic views. All of this is also blending to inspire and open us all now to higher realities. Being conscious, aware of who we truly are by stripping back layers to find the pure essence of our own being, to find and feel something pure and free, to bathe in this force that is so pure that it can change the course of our own evolution with grace and style. All of this is available to us now, and this force within us all is pure, unpolluted and perfect. It is this force that we have in common, and regardless of the trials and tribulations and the daily living tests in life, we are human, but more than that, we are divine beings in human form, and this is a blessing for us all to know, and something that the swamis and sadhus in India are completely focused on. They're not interested in extreme living or feats of mastery on the physical body level, and this includes living purely on prana, which many of their yogis have long been able to do. The swamis' interest, the sadhus, the holy ones of India, their focus is only on God realization, that we merge with and become one with the Atman, that we experience the Atman's Shakti, Shakti being its amazing flows of love. Shaktipat Sadhana. This is the service of being a divine cosmic transmission station for pure love, and it is something that we have focused on often in the West when we have traveled the world and met with the others who have been open to such frequency emanations. In India, Shaktipat is something so enjoyed by others. It is an energy that flows out of a being who is at one with the Atman, tuned in divine marriage with the God within, totally knowing its wisdom, feeling its love, being that pure and perfect energy. So many experiences happen to anyone who enters into India's energy field, just as it happens when we sit in silence in meditation and seek to know who we really are.